You know, as I was praying, the Lord led me to a passage in the book of Isaiah. And the book of Isaiah, at that time, there was a time of uncertainty. There's a time of tribulation. There's a time even of barrenness. And the people of Israel was lost. How many know that every time when the people of God feels lost, God has a prophetic word? In Isaiah 35, the prophet began to speak a prophetic word. And the word came across as this, that the wilderness and the solitary place shall be glad for them, and the desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose. A word of hope. In all the uncertainties, there was the word of hope. And it said, go on, it shall blossom abundantly and rejoice even with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given unto it, the excellence of Carmel and Sharon. And here comes this assurance that even in times of uncertainties, in times where there seems to be no hope, where there seems to be a sense of discouragement and helplessness, I want you to hear this. The Word of God says, they shall see the glory of the Lord and the excellence of my God. Amen. You know that this is a tremendous assurance. I know if you look at the newspapers today, if you look at even perhaps the companies you're working with, if you're looking at your P&L sheets and all those, you will say, wow, there seems to be no hope. But I want to tell you this. If your hope is looking at the things that's around you, if your hope is in trusting because you need even a healing from God and you're looking at medical signs, I want to tell you this. There's only one hope. And that hope comes when God releases a prophetic word into your life. Because without a prophetic word to lead and to guide, you know the Word of God says, without a vision, the people of God perish. And today, even as we live in this world of uncertainty and confusion, too often we are trying to use our own strength. We're trying to use our own understanding. We're trying to use even, yes, the intellect that God has given us. Nothing wrong with that. Don't get me wrong. God intends that you do use your intellect. But there's a difference when you become totally reliant upon your own selves and your own intellect and your own leading and your own guidance. You see, the Spirit of God is always there for us. And God has given this to us, the intellect. And God has given us the freedom of choice to make decisions in this life. And how many know that God is not going to interfere with your right of choice and decisions? But God is always looking for you to look to Him for leading and guidance. And here in the Word of God in verse 3 say, strengthen ye the weak hands. Some versions say, lift up your hands that hang down. Why do you lift up? Lift up towards a future and a hope that can only come from heavenly dimensions. And it says here, and confirm the feeble knees. When your legs feel like you're going to crumple, amen. How many know that if you've never done before, if you come here and you're asked to stand a pulpit, your legs start to shake, amen. How many know that in times of things that you've never done before, there's always a fear. And the Word of God comes, say to them that are of a fearful heart, amen. We sang a song just now, those that are fearful hearted. He says, say to them that are of fearful heart, be strong, fear not. And tonight I sense this, the first thing that God wants us to know and for me to release in this place is a prophetic anointing in two words. And these two words are here. Be strong, fear not. And when you're strong and you fear not, the conclusion, behold, your God will come. He will come with a vengeance. Even God will, with a recompense, for He will come and save you. You know, these words are so important. This word save. Now, when we think of the word save, what comes to your mind? Well, you know, this word in the Hebrew word in the original language is a mix of two words. But the root of that word actually comes from the word yaha, which actually talks about when we are open. It talks about something that's wide. It talks about something that brings you into a liberty, to a freedom. It also talks about something that will help preserve, bring salvation, bring a victory in your life over whatever situation that you're facing. But even more, it is the nuance of the word is not something in eternity. That word is a word that is for here and now. It carries a promise. When it says, save me, that word is saying, practically calling God, I need to get saved here right now. Amen. How many know that? You got issues, you got problems, you got health problems, whatever problems you have. You don't need the solution when you go and see God in the street by and by. Oh, y'all don't believe that. You need a solution right here. And that's the importance. In this root word of Yasha becomes the word that actually goes to the very name of Jesus itself, Yeshua. And as we study that word, you realize something. The word save also carries even deliverance from sickness. And it talks about a final objective and a goal. And the final objective and a goal is something that is right now, right here. Healing, not just healing, but a restoration to even health. A restoration. How many know that God is not a God only that wants to come to reconcile? Jesus came to what? Reconcile us to God. But Jesus came also to restore. Amen. Whatever you have lost, whatever you're going through right now, when salvation comes, it's not just to get you saved, and that's the Greek equivalent, sozo, and sozo doesn't mean you get saved to go to heaven only. Amen. How many know that you need the salvation to be here and now? And this is so important. And look at the next verse here. When he talks about save you, then verse 5 says, then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap as a deer, and the tongue of the dumb sing. For in the wilderness shall waters break out and streams in the desert. Because he's the same God yesterday, and I want to declare this, the same God today and will be forever. The same God that the prophet Isaiah said is the God that puts highways in the wilderness, rivers in the desert. And that's what our God is about. A God that the glory, when it comes, bring miracles, bring signs, bring wonders. But it's not just to meet your needs. Amen. How many know that when the glory of God comes, it is for the very purpose to fulfill the intent of what God has for you and me in our lives today? And this word is important. Next one says and goes, and the parched ground shall become a pool, and the thirsty land springs of water, in the inhabitations of dragons, where each lair shall be grass with reeds and rushes. And a highway shall be there, and a way, and it shall be called, I want you to hear the word, the highway of holiness. Amen. Sin separates us from God. God calls us to be separated for Him. And I want you to hear this. It's God who prepares a way. And the Word of God tells us there that there shall be a highway of holiness. And here comes the warning. The unclean shall not pass over it, but it shall be for those, the wayfaring men, though fools. Amen. How many of you sometimes feel so foolish about things? Shall not enter therein. But in the highway of holiness, there's safety that God has prepared. The Bible says here in verse 9, no lion shall be there, nor any ravenous beast shall go up thereof. It shall not be found there, and the redeemed shall walk there. And the ransom of the Lord shall return. Hear this word. And the ransomed of the Lord shall return, and come to Zion with songs and everlasting joy upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. Amen. This is not just a word, a prophetic word for Israel at the time, at that season, and what they were facing right now. I want you to hear this. In this Rima, the Lord spoke to me, there is a prophetic word for the coming of Jesus. And I want you to hear this. That indeed, John chapter 1 verse 14 tells us that the word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld, I want to hear this, beheld the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. You notice two words, grace, but coupled with truth. But preceding the grace comes the glory. And here, even in the book of Isaiah, hear that prophecy again. They shall see the glory of the Lord and the excellence of our God. I want you to hear this prophetic word. It's about the coming of the Messiah, when the glory of God will be resting on the Messiah himself. A man that is the Son of God in every way, but also became the Son of Man. A man that laid aside divinity to become frail humanity, to be born of the line of a woman, but yet to be found without sin. That he could be and will be and has been that which has paid the price. And for all who believe, how many want to declare this? We are the ransom. The price has already been paid. A highway has been prepared. A place of safety, a place of restoration, a place of healing, a place of the abundance and providence of God, the provision of God, no matter, whatever the circumstances they're still facing in a world that's not yet redeemed. Somebody shout amen. And here, the Word of God says, and listen to this, the unclean shall not pass over. The unclean shall not pass over. You know, as I was deliberating upon this, you know what the Lord said to me? If the people can understand this, I've already paid the price. And whatever you need right now, the power of God has already been released. Not just the glory of the only begotten that we see, but God say, listen, Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth, Son of God that became Son of Man, anointed him with what? The Holy Spirit and with power. And he went around doing good and healing all the oppressed of the devil. Now, what does the word say? That's what he did. Now, we can have a confirmation of this. As Jesus lived and as he walked, you remember the time, 30 years old, he was led by the Holy Spirit to go to the River Jordan to be baptized by his own cousin, John the Baptist. As he approached the river, the anointing of God that was upon John the Baptist, as he looked up, he saw Jesus coming. And he declared, behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. And you all remember the story of how Jesus came to ask him to baptize him. And the first reaction, John said, how can I baptize you? I only baptize with a baptism of repentance. You are the very Lamb that takes away all the sins. Who am I to baptize you? But Jesus said, do it, because there is a reason. Amen. How many know that John the Baptist, being the forerunner of Jesus, was going to do a very act that God wanted to use a man The anointing upon a man. How many know that the anointing to work right here on earth, God uses a man. You hear what I'm saying? And the anointing that came upon him, that when he baptized Jesus, God then anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit. You see that whole scenario there? But here now, if you look at Matthew chapter 11, very interesting verse. And Matthew chapter 11 tells us of a time that John the Baptist was facing situations. He had been arrested. He had tried to be the representation of God to even tell the king that was in government that he is a sinner, that he's got to change. And of course, he got imprisoned. And there was a danger now of him getting executed. In that time, how many know that? In times of uncertainties, in times of confusion. You know what happened to John the Baptist? The same man that baptized Jesus, the same man that declared, "Behold, the Lamb of God," now in prison, all of a sudden, he lost hope. How many know that when we are facing difficult situations, if we are not focused right, we can be caught up by circumstances, we be caught up by situation, and we who have been ransomed, we who have been redeemed, who have been promised the promises of God, not only for eternity, but here and now. You know what happened to John the Baptist? He became so uncertain. He told some of the disciples, "Go and check out my cousin, Jesus. Go and check out what?" He sent, but the Bible says in 11 verse 2, he sent two of his disciples. He said to the disciples, "Go and check out. Ask, is he the one that should come? Or do we look for another?" Man. Do you know, times I believe God will always look down from heaven and say, "I've done everything. I can even use you." Let me tell you this. It does not mean that just because God has used us. I shared this with my class the other night, on Thursday night. I said in the power of faith that there are times too when also doubt and uncertainty hits me. People said to me, "Oh, but Pastor, you got such great faith." How many know? We can have faith. But you see, the key is, who is the source of your faith? Most of the time, the source of faith is determined, unfortunately, by circumstances, situation, what our eyes will see, what our ears will hear, even how deception can even fool our hearts. And we can even turn away and don't understand the anointing of God. Let me tell you this. I shared certain things. Some of them in my class will tell you about it. Personal. But that's why the Bible challenges us that we have to not just fight the fight of faith, but fight the good fight of faith. And here I want you to see this. To fight the good fight of faith, and is to be, yes, you need to inquire. Don't worry. If you don't understand what God is doing, let me tell you, there are times even when I go in my seasons of doubt and unbelief. How many know that we can be believers without unbelief? Amen? Because we are caught by circumstances, we're caught by situation, we're caught by what our eyes see, what our ears hear, and even what the devil is trying to sow in our heart. Doubt, fear, unbelief, uncertainty, confusion, circumstance, situations. And we can be like John the Baptist. Go ask, check it out. Is he the one? Oh. And look at what Jesus answered and said to them. "Go and show John again those things which you do hear and see." Notice these two words. Those things which you do hear and see. I'll repeat this again. Those things that you do hear and see. You see, God never sent His word. He sent His word with a purpose. The Bible says, God sent His word and healed them all of their destruction. I'm quoting on Psalm 107. He healed the word to heal them of all their diseases. All means all. Was there power enough to do it all? Yes. Even when the shadow of Jesus went by, people got healed because they were brought by the side of the road. There was enough power. But yet, as I look in the life of Jesus, like when Jesus went to the pool of Bethesda, the Bible says there were five verandas, five patios, five of them around that pool. And there were many sick, many infirm, many people with disease, all at the side of the pool. What were they waiting for? They were waiting for a word, they believe. That every now and then an angel will come and stir the pool. When the pool is stirred, whoever gets in get healed. So they were all there waiting. You see, times we can believe that God can heal, but yet our eyes are looking at the wrong things. And the Bible records that only one man got healed out of I don't know how many men there were in all the five verandas, the five patios that were there. One. Was there enough power to heal? Yes. But only one got healed. In fact, in Luke chapter 5, the Word of God tells us something. I think it's verse 17. Yeah. And there it says that he was in a room of teaching. There were Pharisees. There were people of the law. There were all sorts of people in needs there. And the Bible says this very word. And there was sufficient power to heal all. But do you know there's only one man that got healed? One man that was carried by four friends. Four friends who carried him right up to the door of the very house where Jesus was in. Crowds was there. The doors, the inside was all filled up. People outside. They couldn't get in. They look at the window, cannot get in. But you see, these four friends did not give up. What did the Bible tell us these four friends did? They checked it out. They found out where Jesus was sitting in the house. And they carried this friend in a bed right up these narrow steps onto the roof. And they were trying to estimate where Jesus sat in a house below. And they know what they did? They started digging a hole. They started digging a hole because they believed that if they could get their friend into the very presence of the healing anointing of God, their friend could be healed. Now, I don't know how big a hole they dug there. But it must have a big hole because they say that he lowered him on a bed. Lord, him a bed means the bed must be like that. So the hole must be big enough for the bed to be lowered. And I want to tell you this. My Bible says, and Jesus seeing their faith. How many know faith can be seen? Faith is not just what you believe. Faith can be seen in how you respond. I want to shout this again. Faith can be seen in how you respond. The problem is, many of us are not focused upon the author and finisher of our faith. Let me repeat this. Who is the author and finisher of our faith? Probably I say Jesus. But many can be focused on circumstances. Many can focus on situations. Many can be focused on the wrong things because how many know the devil does not want you to be saved? Fiery darts will come. You begin to see through the eyes of sight. You can begin to hear things that you want to hear. Your heart can be so believing in God, but yet be so condemned by deception. And if you don't know how to keep your eyes upon Jesus as the author and finisher of your faith, how many know that you will receive nothing? Instead, you always receive the wrong things. And you'll be caught up like anybody else that's not been ransomed. Like anybody else that has not been redeemed. I'm not trying to put a curse on anybody. Because tonight, I come. And I believe there is the anointing of God, the presence of God is here. The glory of God is already here. And Jesus said, simple. You tell John what you do hear and do see. Because when the word of God is preached, God, the Bible says, Jesus said it himself, will confirm the preaching of the word with signs following. Amen? Hear this word of God. Then what? You see the fruit. So what do you see? In verse 5, Jesus said, the blind receive their sight, and the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. And blessed is he, whosoever shall not be offended by my word. Do you know that one of the biggest weapons, I want you to hear these people of God, that is loosed right now in this world is offense. The devil knows, if I can get you offended, your eyes will no longer Jesus. Your eyes will be upon offense. How many know the devil is working very hard now? We are in those final days of the end times. The glory of God, Habakkuk 2:14. The knowledge of the very glory of God is waiting to cover the earth as the water covers the sea. And this glory of God, when it comes, it's not just a light that will shine. It's not just a woozy feeling that we feel. This glory is not when you are in a worship hall and as you worship, wow, you feel goosebumps and say, God is here. I want to tell you this. The glory of God is manifested for a purpose. The glory of God is the very anointing of God. It is a manifested presence of God. In the testimony, you have seen it as the cloud by day, the fire by night, the burning bush that does not consume. But how many know that the glory of God is God himself? When the glory of God comes, it's like a spirit. Where it comes, where it goes, you and I would not know. Can we feel his presence? Yes. Not only feel his presence. You see, the word of God tells us that at the time of the consecration of the temple built by Solomon in Jerusalem, at the time of this consecration, there was such a Shekinah glory of God that came into this temple. A Shekinah glory that they cannot feel, cannot grasp hold of. But yet the Shekinah glory, the very presence of God himself, when he came into the temple, you know what happened? Even the priest was ministering in the temple could not stand. There was such a presence. You know, rabbis wrote about this presence. That is like a take, something very heavy, something very thick, something came in. They couldn't explain it. But all they know is they could not stand in the very presence of the Shekinah glory. It didn't say there was just goosebumps alone. I won't tell you this. How did that Shekinah glory of God come? How did that manifestation of God in such a glorious dimension come? Do you know, I just said it. Every time the manifestation of God comes, the purpose of God will be fulfilled. When the anointing is there, when you touch the anointing, you don't touch the glory, you touch the anointing. You touch that manifestation. I believe this, whatever your need is, will be met. Amen. You need to keep your eyes, however, on Jesus as the author and finisher of faith. You got to remember, like Paul says, only in Him alone can I live, can I move, and can I have my being. I won't tell you thing that everything else does not qualify you if you have not purified. God already did the work of purification, but our responsibility is to keep ourselves purified. And that was a key. Now, I want to show you the key. The Lord spoke this key to Solomon at the time of the consecration. 2 Chronicles 7:14. He says, if my people who are called by my name. Is he talking to believers? I believe so. Amen. You'll be called by his name if you are not a believer. Is he talking to people of ransom? I believe so. Because you're called by his name. Is he talking about people that is redeemed? I believe so. That's a prophetic word for us today. If my people who are called by my name, what do you have to do? Nothing you can do except, he says, humble yourself. Notice this word, humble yourself, is very interesting. A lot of times we think humble ourselves is like going to fall, grovel, you know, we got to like crawl. Yeah, but there's a humbling. I remember this because once I was in business, I went to the palace in Thailand, you know, with my distributors, and the crown prince walked in, and we were seated on the floor. We could not even stand up. And when his signal come, you know, my distributors started crawling, really humbling themselves. That is a human way of humbling. But God is not talking about groveling. Somebody say amen. God is not looking at the posture of your body. God is looking at the attitude of your heart. I want to pause here a minute. How do I see the attitude of your heart? The Bible says, humbling. You know, a lot of times when I'm teaching, I'm sharing. This word humbling comes to my mind. Because really, one way that we humble ourselves is actually we need to erase all that you have been taught, all that you have been learned, all that you have experienced, your years of growing up, your years of sitting in church, having mindsets. Amen. How do you know that God wants you to be like Him? The Word of God in Romans tell us, God says what? He has predestinated. You know what's predestinated? Means He already made a decision for your life, for destiny. So some people say, oh yeah, this predestination means some people go to heaven, some people go to hell. How many believe that? No, it's also quiet all of a sudden. No, see this concept. You see, Lord, people think we are predestined. Oh, your poor Judas, you know, he was predestined to go to hell already. Actually, not true. Do you know that Judas had freedom of choice? Right until the last minute, when he dipped his sop in, Jesus said, now, go and do what you have to do. And the Bible says, at that moment, the devil entered him. Up to then, he still had free choice. But because he did not want to repent, you see, the long patience of God, the ever long suffering grace of God. My Bible tells me that God has that long suffering patience and grace. But how many know that the Bible is very clear? The Word of God is the Word of God in the New Testament. Word of God says in the author of Hebrews, lest you fail of the grace of God. How do people fail of the grace of God? If you want to persist in your own ways. Your mindsets. I won't tell you this. When you have mindsets, strongholds are there. No teaching can come. Holy Spirit cannot come to keep you in remembrance of what Jesus is teaching you, because you are caught up with the teaching of man. You're caught up with the circumstances of the fallen world. You're caught up with concept ideas, the heart that's so deceitful that will deceive you. Is there no hope? Obviously, there's a hope. God says, learn to humble yourself. Humbling yourself means submit yourself to God again. Strongholds have to go. Mindsets have to change. Do you know that's what made me change my life? I've lived, born a Christian, grew up to a very traditional Christian family of pastors. I tell you this, did I have mindsets? Boy, did I have mindsets! I went through a Sunday school in a Methodist church, became a Sunday school teacher. I was helping to lead Bible study groups. Did I have mindsets? Oh yes, I tell you. I had such religious mindsets. Let me tell you that I believe that true worship is only the organ, the piano, the choir. Again, laugh, don't worry. I will tell you this. Even I got saved again in 1990. By that time, I was over 40 years old already. Don't try and guess my age. 1990, I was already over 40 years old. Do you know, did I still have mindsets? Well, I was filled with the Holy Spirit. I was praying in tongues. I was moving, praying for the sick. I was into church leadership. But did I have mindsets? Yes. Do you know what prevented me from entering into the fullness of what God had? These mindsets had to be destroyed. And let me tell you how God destroyed my mindsets. Because in the old days, I was a man of the world. To me, I've been brought up one thing. Money, money, money is a rich man's world. You see, when God knows, these are the things you deal with. When you submit yourself to God, God made me a bankrupt. Because he had to destroy that. Because only in destroying what is your focus, then your heart can get changed. Today, my wife will tell you, I'm afraid. Afraid what? That my heart will deceive me again. Yeah, I've got offers. People have said to me, come, we want you to be a consultant in the company. I've been offered all sorts of salaries. No, because why? God says, no. Amen. I've come to the point, God says no means no. I don't care about what the world is telling me. People tell you you're so stupid. Amen. I want to tell you this. I've only found one thing. I've served God. Now, I look back from the day I started serving him. You know, I was just counting it. More than 26 years now, where I started ministering for God. And 19 years of that in full-time ministry. But do you know that I was really, really broken after 1998. All the way from 1990, I want to tell you this. Whatever I was doing for God, I was like the man who says, Lord, did I not cast out demons in the name? Did I not do this? I knew that. And remember, the word of God says, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, I know you not. I was like that. I was busy for God, but yet not obedient to what God wanted me to do. Because I have not dealt with the things that were before me. There needs to be a breaking in our life, yes. When God wants to use you, as much is to be given, much is required. If my people were called by my name, will first humble themselves. Humble yourself to let God do what he wants to do in your life. That's the important key. Sure, you have a need. Amen? God can meet your need. But God wants you to enter into your destiny. I want you to hear this. Predestination is not to get saved or go to hell. Predestination, read the book of Romans correctly. You are predestinated to conform to the image of Jesus Christ. God wants you to conform to the image. Jesus was tested. Yes. The Bible says so. For 30 years, he was tested every way before the Holy Spirit anointing came on him. By grace, God has also allowed the Holy Spirit to come with us now. But the word must be established. You see, call by name, will first humble themselves. What does humbling require? The Bible says pray. How many are praying? It's good to pray. But God didn't stop there and say pray. He said pray. But next thing, seek my face. Do you know that no one that's unclean can come and see the face of God? No one. Seek my face. As you seek the face of God, what happens? Conviction of sin will come. He says, then you will turn from your wicked ways. Hello? Is God speaking to believers? Yes. How do you know we still got a lot of wicked ways in us? Yes. Don't look at me. I also still got wicked ways. Because I've seen the flesh. And it's still a daily. I just text this to some people that I know. You know, I say when I have a reunion with my classmates, some will come up to me and say, "Ayah, you die." My hair, you die. D-Y-E. And my answer is, no, I die daily. So that I can be resurrected daily into a newness of life. But more important, not just resurrected daily, but to walk in that newness of life. How many of God has a place of victory? God has a place, that secret place for you. When you are able to be in under His shadow. And how many know Psalm 91 says, nothing comes nigh you. Not sickness, not disease, not pestilence, not anything. Not even financial problems. Amen. Because you learn to walk, not just in the think you need like a healing or restoration, but you walk in the anointing as Jesus walks. Amen. Conform to the image and after the very likeness of Christ. Does the devil still try and take? Of course. Did he not try to take Jesus? Of course. Amen. But you see, as we humble ourselves, pray, seek His face, turn from wicked ways. Then God says, and this is the assurance now. Then He says, my eyes will be, no, before that, that then I will hear from heaven. I will forgive your sins. I will heal the land. But I love this promise in the next verse. And my eyes will be open. Look at you. My ears will be listening attentively. Because God wants a relationship with you. The highway of holiness has been prepared. The price has been paid. All who believe can be redeemed, ransomed. But you need to, Isaiah said, mount up on a highway of holiness. On the holy highway of holiness. If you stay on the highway, the problem is often we come off the highway every now and then. Hello, I'm not talking to you. I'm reminding myself that is when we step off the highway, because on the highway, there's no ravenous beast waiting to kill, to steal, and destroy. Amen? There's no lions waiting to devour you. Amen? You walk with the Lion of Judah. And I want to tell you this. You become the head and not the tail. You become above and not beneath. The world will not understand you. Amen? Okay? Your hearts will get changed. Healing, not just healing. That's why the Apostle John said this. John 3. John 2 or 3. 3. Beloved, I wish for you above all things that you prosper and be in health. John 2, 3, I think. Even as your soul prospers. Amen. God is looking at the prosperity of your soul. God wants you to bring you in a line. The devil is the one that wants to distract you, to keep you not on a highway of holiness, where the protection, where the abundance, where the providence of God. I want to tell you this. I stand to testify that you will not be caught by the world economy. Yes, it was in 1998, in the middle of the great Asian economic crisis, that God says, you now go to full-time ministry. God provided. Let me tell you this. I was finished. God provided. There were tests to come. In 2001, God moved us from our first center to the second center. How many know 2001, there was an even greater economic crisis? September 11. My wife remember, we prophesied, God says there's going to be a big downturn. And we moved in 2001. Now the first Covenant Vision at Ampas to the second Covenant Vision at Balestier Road, 2001. I know God has showed this all the time. He said, if you walk in my ways, I will use you to show the world that my people are not caught by the world. This is true. In 2003, God provided. We moved another, the third Covenant Vision at Tyreek Road. Yeah. In 2005, when we already in 2014, yeah, we prophesied. Oh, yeah, no. Let me go back a bit. 2007, I gave the word. You can still check, it's still on our website. There'll be record highs at the beginning of record lows. And 2008, when there was right the economic recession, God says, now you start the church. We do the things that are impossible. I still remember 2015, we already prophesied economic recession in 2015. God says, now you move here. Amen. I want you to hear this. It's not about how clever I am. It's not about how good I am. It's not about how I've got so much abilities. I'll tell you this. It is not by my own strength, not by my own might, not by my own abilities anymore. Amen? But I tell you this, if you set your ways to walk in the way of God, does the devil still come to kill, to steal, destroy? He will try. Amen? But how many know this? If you know your power and your position in Christ, you have S.A. Tan under your feet. Somebody shout hallelujah. And I tell you this, when God in Psalm 91 says what? All these things will not come nigh you. Amen? You are able to declare, the Lord is my refuge, my fortress. The Lord will be my provider. He's going to be your healer. He's going to be your restorer. What? Understand something. The battle belongs to Him. He fights the battle for you. Amen. Let's quieten our hearts now. Hallelujah. Shandara bohondo rabahanda. Shandara bohondo rabakara bohondo. Father, we just thank you, Lord. I ask this, Lord, as your people, as we gather before you. God, we ask you for your very presence and anointing that will come upon each and every one of us. I ask, God, that you would even bring the cleansing power of your Holy Spirit. We know the season time is now, Lord. You are looking for the manifestation of your glory. Through the sons of glory, your word said. Because the whole of creation is groaning, even right now, for the manifestation of your sons and daughters. God, you show us that the manifestation would not be in the enticing wisdom of man's word, but in a demonstration of Holy Spirit and power. We ask, Holy Spirit, you come right now, Lord. You know the needs to hear, Lord. But I hear your word, you're not moved by needs, you're moved by faith. Lord, you know the destiny you have for each and every one that's here. Your word reminds us there are only plans of good and not evil. Plans to give hope in the future. So Holy Spirit, I ask right now, come. Write upon this clean slate again, Lord. Empower us, Lord. Enable us, Lord. It's not about how clever we are or what we can do for you, God. It's God in our weakness. Is your strength perfected? When we are weak, God, you are strong. When we know that we can't do anything, God, you already have the answer. You already have the miracle. You already have the destiny. You already have the place of significance, God. I ask, Lord of glory, come right now. Holy Spirit, you bring the word. They will just begin, Lord, a word of conviction, Lord. A word that will just bring, Father, your presence into our lives. Your word reminds us, God, that you're present everywhere. But it's only in your presence, you say, God. In your presence, there can be the fullness of joy. And that joy will be a source of strength for us. In that strength, God, you call us, Lord, to come before you. To go from peace to peace. From faith to faith. From glory to glory. So people, God, hear this word. The glory of our Lord and the excellence of our God. The price been paid is ready here for you. But I've shared these words that the Lord put in my heart. Turn from our wicked ways. This is between you and God right now. I don't need you to raise your hands to say anything except, God, I want to invite you afresh into my life. I want to ask God that you begin a work of refreshing right now. Holy Spirit, your word says, if I confess my sins, your word says that you are faithful, not only to forgive, but to cleanse off every iniquity. God, we ask you that you cleanse us of every wicked way that's here. We ask you, Lord, to cleanse off every impurity, Lord. This is a season, God, right now, we need to mount up on the highway of holiness. We need to stay and walk on the highway of holiness. We need to walk in your abundance, your providence, your provision, Lord. We need to be set free of all the world is trying to do to pull us down. Holy Spirit, I thank you right now. You anointed Jesus Nazareth with the Holy Spirit. God, I ask for anointing of Holy Spirit to come afresh. Let the Holy Spirit come with your goodness, God. Let the Holy Spirit come with that power. Let the Holy Spirit bring healing, restoration. Remember this between you and God. Confess whatever you feel God is telling you. The Holy Spirit may be speaking to you about certain areas. You can go to God directly. There are many things that the devil wants to bring us to trap us. But God wants to bring us into liberty, the glory, the power, and a manifestation of it in your life. The devil works in different ways. How many know that financial bondage is one of them? The Word of God reminds us, if you are a borrower even right now, you cannot be a servant to the Lord, but you end up to be a servant of the lender. But God wants to set you free even right now. If you seek God, I tell you this, God will break the work of every spirit of poverty, every spirit of financial indebtedness. God did it for me, God can do it for you. But it's a personal thing between you and God right now. And God wants to set you free. If you have problems in relationships right now, you must understand that Jesus came to reconcile us to God. And He left also the ministry of reconciliation, that we can be reconciled even with the people around us. Reconciliation does not come unless forgiveness is first given. But as forgiveness is given, the Lord has taught me a second thing. True forgiveness comes when we accept the people who have hurt us. Forgiveness removes. Yes? Forgiveness removes something. It removes the sense of guilt. By acceptance removes the shame. And only when the shame is removed in a relationship can restoration and reconciliation begin. If you're going through this right now, it's between you and God. Ask God for grace. Ask God even for glory that enable you not only to forgive, but to accept the people. The third thing I hear down here is very important. Turn your heart back to God. Today, the spirit of mammon works very strongly in this society which is urbanized, which is pluralistic. The spirit of mammon is working right now through materialism, consumerism, and all the isms. In the time of Israel, there were all the Hittites, the Titites, and all the tites. But in this season right now, the devil is using a lot of isms. We need to go to God and say, Lord, I surrender all this to you. God is still the same yesterday, today, and will be forever. He's still able to do exceedingly, abundantly, even above all that you can ask or imagine. I know that the sickness, yes, the spirit of infirmity and debility of sickness and cancer even still working right now. It's because of the fallen world. But how many know that we can add to this fallen world and allow the devil to work through? One of the biggest things is stress. You know, the Lord showed me that the spirit of cancer works because many of us got stress. But many people come to me and say, Pastor, I only thrive under stress. How many know God made your body not for stress, but for shalom and the peace of God? The peace that can go beyond our human understanding. Sickness, disease come. Stress. Only God can give you peace. But peace cannot come unless you first submit and surrender. If you're going through that right now, ask God to help you. Ask the Holy Spirit to come to help you stop striving. So, Father, I commit all this to you right now. You're the God that restores, you're the God that reconciles. And I'm going to give an opportunity for you, if God is speaking to you, take a few minutes to talk to God. As I said, ask God first. Get rid of all the mindsets. Get rid of all the strongholds that are there. God, let my mind be like a clean slate that Holy Spirit, you can begin to write on it. How many know that when your minds get renewed, your heart will change? as your heart gets changed, you'll be able to present your bodies then. The conviction will come to enable you to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, as holy and acceptable unto the Lord. Then I will tell you this. You can then walk in the abundance of providence and provision of God. No more stress. Amen. All of a sudden you find it, you don't even worry your finances anymore. Amen. Just take a few moments, talk to God. There are a few things I've said.